I'm Marty Ramsey, and this is the March edition of Western Wednesday. Western Wednesday is a podcast produced by the Office of Advancement at Western Carolina University, where we showcase the impact our alumni are having here at WCU and around the world. In the fall of 2021, WCU opened the doors of a brand new $110 million science building bearing the name of one of the university's fiercest advocates, Senator Tom Apodaca. This state-of-the-art building was part of a $2 billion state bond that was approved by voters and just one of the many projects supported by Senator Apodaca during his tenure in the state legislature. Since most folks haven't been able to see the 183,000 square foot building in person, we decided to bring the building to you. We had the chance to take a tour through the building with Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, David Kenner, to see the impact this facility is going to have on our students. To view the video that accompanies this tour, visit go.wcu.edu/Western Wednesdays. We hope you enjoy the show.
First of all, this building is a labor of love. It was a lot of work as well, but it is something that we're really proud of and spent a lot of time. When we started the planning process, I was the associate dean, and so was able to see the whole process occur. And honestly, we're still working on it today. We're still finishing up a few things and really learning how to use all the new spaces. So as we look from the outside, you can see from this drone footage the building, which is on the left, and how it connects to the Stillwell building on the right. And one of the things about it, just to kind of remind you, is that this was funded by the people of North Carolina. So this is really your building. It's a $110 million building that was part of the NC Connect bond. And when it was all finished, it's 185,000 square feet, half of which is space that we actually use. And the rest of it is all the mechanical stuff that is needed to run a science building. So as we go through the tour today, we're going to do it a little bit like I would if you were here in person, and that is to kind of look at the different types of spaces in the building. So I'll show you some classrooms, some teaching labs, some research labs, all sorts of different offices, some outdoor space that we're particularly proud of, and also some other spaces like the herbarium. The other thing you'll see as we're going through is there's a lot of spaces for students to sit and be within this building. There's a lot of soft seating and places for students to be, which was not the case in the old building. Now, in the beginning of this planning process, we actually had committees that kind of got together and worked with the architects. And the goal of those committees was to kind of have some principles that we were using to kind of design the building. And one of those things, since we're outside kind of looking in, one of those things is a sense of place. And I know many of you love Western, particularly its location. And so we were really interested in this idea of sense of place. What does it mean to have a uniquely Western building? And so we challenged the architects to do that. But my view is that they came through. So one of the things that we know about now in particular, we've been doing a lot of archaeology on campus, so we know that this was once a Cherokee place called Two Sparrows Place. In fact, there were structures under the existing building. And so one of the things that we wanted to incorporate in the design was kind of a remembrance of the Cherokee. And so as we zoom out here, at one point in time, we'll zoom out in 1 second, you'll see the Killian Building. And the Killian Building was the center of that settlement. So right there in the corner there, you can see the Killian Building. And at one time, there was a mound there that was the center of Two Sparrows Place. And so on the pavement that you can see right there, the white pavement, those gray lines basically echo. So they kind of have the same shape as the mound, and they echo out towards the building to remind us of that place. As we go inside, you'll see some other things that represent both our natural setting and also look a little bit at the early history of the campus. So a couple other things that were key design concepts. One is that we really wanted to build community. So we wanted students to be, we know if students are kind of around and they feel at home, they learn better. And so we wanted to create a lot of space where they could feel like that they were invested in the building and that they really wanted to be there working. With that, the other key thing is that none of us do science alone. So I'm a geologist. I work with a lot of people when I do science, and that's very common today. And so we want to have spaces where people could do a lot of collaboration, including labs that have multiple scientists and students working in them. So that's another key design concept. And then the final one on this slide is that I want to talk a little bit about updated spaces. So it's hard to convince people that they're doing something technologically current and they're going to a career in science and have a really old building and really old equipment. So we really wanted to upgrade that so that students are using equipment and are in spaces like they would encounter when they go into the workforce. So that was really important. The other two concepts that were really key, one was flexibility in our spaces. So you'll see a lot of furniture on wheels that we can move around. And part of that is people teach very differently. Some people do a lot of lecturing, others do a lot of group learning. And so being able to move the furniture around and also allowing us as teaching changes, because the last science building was built in the 70s, right? So we want to make sure that we're able to kind of evolve as the way that we teach changes. And then finally, we have a lot of science on display. So as you go through the building, you'll see a lot of windows that are internal that allow people to see into the labs and really get a sense of what it's like to be a scientist. And as you can see here, the windows that are on the outside of the building, so that's the Apodaca building, that allows light in. And then the other benefit of having a lot of internal windows is allows light into those interior spaces. Before we go on to the next slide, you could see that to the right here, we have the old natural science building. That's no longer there. You'll be able to see in a slide that's coming up what that looks like now. On the left, you can see the Stillwell building, which is attached directly to the Apodaca building on the back. And you can also see the slate on the outside of the Apodaca building there. So as you come in here, you see the entrance to the building, and you see the plaques that commemorate Tom Apodaca and also the building's opening. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. Behind it, you can see that there is there are a lot of stone walls in these spaces, and those commemorate the part of campus, particularly on the hill where there's a lot of stone walls, and kind of give a nod to that. And then as you go along this entrance hallway, you'll see there's a lot of old pictures of the campus. And you can see most of these pictures. We have archives, you know, through our library. We can actually see these online. But it was important for us really to capture the history, particularly of this site. And it was really interesting in the beginning to see a lot of students gathering around these, really taking a look at what the campus used to look like. So that was pretty cool. But this part of the building has a lot of the classrooms in it. In just a second, we will go to the biggest classroom that we have, which is a 150-seat lecture hall. So here's that lecture hall. As we turn, you can see the windows, and we have shades that keep some of the sun out. But you'll notice that all the furniture is tables and chairs, and it's all can be removed. It's all flexible. And again, this is a pretty big lecture space, but could also be used for events and things like that, which has been really, really cool. So we've started using that. So this area is a particular feature in the building called the Gorge. And again, it's another nod to kind of our environment that's around here. And currently on the second floor, and as you walk down these stairs, you go to the first floor, and if you turn there, you can look into the area that's called the Commons. On the second floor, you'll see right there that it's actually linked to Stillwell. And so that dark hallway was the Stillwell building. It's only even with Stillwell on the second floor. Every other floor is a little bit offset from Stillwell because the floors in Apodaca are a little bit higher than the ones in Stillwell. But that allows you to kind of create a neighborhood between Stillwell and the Apodaca building, which has been pretty cool. The other thing you'll see as we move here is that wall that's on the back there with the paneling that's layered. And that kind of relates to rock layering and again is another indication of the natural setting that we have here in Western North Carolina. The cool thing about the Gorge is it divides the part that we're looking in. So that direction, as we turn, that's the interior of the building where we have most of our departmental spaces. And behind us is where you go in, and most of the general classrooms that we have are there. So we're now going to go directly into a classroom. And so I wanted to show folks this classroom. This is what we call a high flex room. And again, it really relates to how flexible these spaces can be. So first of all, you can see that there are wheels on all the furniture, and those tables and chairs can be moved around. And right now they're facing the front, so whoever was using them last was probably doing a lecture, and you can actually project now on those whiteboards that are in the front. So that works pretty well. We don't actually need screens. As you look around the room, one of the things that we have a lot of in the building is whiteboards. You ask the scientists, what do you need? And they say, oh, we want lots of whiteboards. And in some cases, we actually have whiteboards that are, you know, just hanging on the ends of tables, not particularly in this room. But that allows them students to brainstorm, to do group work. And we also have those screens. And the cool thing about the screens is that we can put the tables around the screens, and we can divide the students into groups, and each group can actually project a computer onto these screens. And so each group can have this, you know, a different image up on one of the screens where maybe it's their work, or maybe it's a photo or something like that, or they can share across the whole room so that the professor can actually say, oh, what this person over here is doing is cool. Let's share it with everybody else. And so that's a pretty key. But again, the key of these spaces is going to be flexibility. So this is just what department offices look like. So we have two departments that actually are centered in this building, the chemistry department and the biology department. Other departments like geosciences and natural resource and mathematics, computer science, also anthropology, our forensic anthropology, have some spaces, but no offices. One of the things you can see is that we have glass windows, and this allows the light to come through and into those spaces. And there's a desk out front for student workers so they can actually direct people in the right direction. But a lot of efficiencies by having these offices kind of in the same place. So now we're going to go into our first classroom. And this classroom is called the sandbox, which gives you the sense of kind of a playful thing. And that's the idea. So this is used for special types of teaching, for example, doing projects, research projects, and project kind of learning, and also for research projects that require the use of space where you have to leave things out for a long period of time. Again, you can see that there's a lot of wheels, so everything can be reconfigured in terms of the furniture. It's a two-story space, and you can see that we have the power in order to give us maximum flexibility. It comes down from the ceiling. And so that allows you to kind of move things around and change the configuration. Our inaugural use of this room this semester is a beer making class. And so we have a professor of biology, Sean O'Connell. He's a microbiologist. And so the students are studying how that process works. They have lecture in here. And then each week in lab, they work on developing a different type of beer and kind of try to understand how that works for different types of beer and that kind of thing. So that's the type of thing we had in mind when we were designing this space. So here is another teaching room. This actually is the room that I teach in, the hydrology lab. You can see because it's the hydrology lab, we do have a lot of drains in the floor. And like the other spaces, it's very flexible. You can move things around. And there's a garage door to bring things in and out of the space. So we do a lot of soil and water labs here. This thing that we're looking at here, this sandbox, is actually a flume. You can run water down that to simulate rivers and also do groundwater or rain in there. And so it's a really fun space for learning about hydrology, and a lot bigger than the spaces that we had in Stillwell. We're now moving down what's known as the commons, and you can see all the seating. We'll come back and take a little better look at that. But I want people to notice on the side here, this cutout area that's a group area, and it's for groups to work. But it also, the wooden area, there's actually three areas that kind of protrude from that wall, that curtain wall, and they represent the original buildings on campus that were once on the hill. So again, it's kind of a nod to the early campus. When we reach the end of that commons, we get to these bleacher stairs. And you can see the bleacher stairs. We'll also talk a little bit more about that. But as we kind of zoom here, you can see to the right that the stairs are actually replicated on the outside. So you have the stairs on the inside and the outside. And these areas are for students to kind of hang out. So this slide here shows kind of what the seating looks like inside. This is a still image. So again, this is in the Commons. And as I said before, one of the things we really wanted to do is to have people be able to sit and really relax and be in the building. And so this soft seating is meant to have students really be able to get comfortable and spend time in the building. You can notice around the seating that it's carpeted. So any area you see in the building that's carpet is really meant for people to stay. And you can see the pathway on the right, that's the polished concrete for people to kind of walk down the hall. So this is a close-up of the stairs, and this student is actually using it as we had kind of intended to be able to sit there. You can see the plugs in order that allow people to plug in. There's Wi-Fi throughout the building so they can do their work there. And basically, when we were doing this, I don't know that we thought about Memorial Stadium, but of course, this is on the site of the old Memorial Stadium, the old football stadium for Western. When we were building the building, all that was unearthed again, so the bleachers were largely in place, and we actually had to excavate and remove those. But this bleacher stairs actually kind of reminds us of that every time we go down there. One of the other things that's nice about the space is we have the plaques from the original Memorial Stadium that basically memorialize those folks from Western that died during World War I and World War II, and those are on the second floor of the building, so people can come see those, and they will remain as part of our building and part of our culture at Western. So this is the third floor, and the third and fourth floors. Third floor is chemistry, the fourth floor is biology. They're pretty much the same, except kind of the mix of what we do in the spaces is a little bit different. So as you can see, this carpeted area here has a mix of seating, and it's really for students to kind of hang out and be able to work kind of close to where their classes and laboratories are. The other thing that we needed for people was to be able to have them have some place to store their stuff. And so we have these lockers so that they can stay longer and be able to use the lockers. Again, you can see the sink that allows them to kind of have lunch. In some of our sinks, we have microwaves and things like that. And we have beautiful views of the mountains that allow and large windows that allow the light to come in. And then internally there, you can see in that lab that there also are windows there that allow light to go further, but also allows people to see what's going on within that lab space. And again, is putting science on display. So I'm now taking you into a teaching lab. So this is the chemistry teaching lab, probably a mid to upper level teaching lab. So there's probably somewhere between 12 and 24 students in this space. We know it's a chemistry lab because of all the hoods. And one of the cool things about this building is that it's really hard to control. This is something I learned during the building process. It's really hard to control the airflow in a place where you have lots of hoods, where you're kind of sucking out air and fumes, because you also have to pump air into those spaces as well. And so it's a lot easier to do, particularly with the technologies and the management systems we have now. So we have about 100 hoods in this building, and all of chemistry is now moved into this space. So we no longer have them in any other building, so we're able to kind of control and have the most efficient systems that are working. The other things you can see, the tables, again, can be moved around. The power comes in from the ceiling. And one other feature, the professors all said, we want to stop tripping on people's bags. And so you can see the cubbies there. So at least in theory, the students can put their bags over there, and we can save some sprained ankles and things like that. So I'm now taking you into kind of the heart of the building. So this is the instrumentation room. And we had an instrumentation room in the old building. It was not quite as fancy looking, but we've always really believed in students doing, experiments and experiential learning and using this equipment. One of the nice things about building a new building is we were able to get new equipment. So some of this equipment we brought with us, and then in some cases where we had really old equipment, we kind of updated it and bought some new stuff. And we're still kind of unpacking everything and getting it ready, although most of the instrumentation is ready to go. We actually have an instrumentation specialist who takes care of it. The key for us particularly that in this case, the Department of Chemistry, is that you learn by doing. And so we want the students to be working on these machines. So we don't have one set of equipment for students and another set for the professors. We're all working in this space, particularly doing research. And we also have classes that teach students how to use these instruments. And the key is that when they're done, they'll have experience and the confidence to do it when they go into industry. So that's a really important thing. That thing that we just looked at that looks like a rocket ship, that is an NMR. And we use that to measure organic molecules. And that's about all I know about it. Being a geologist, I can't tell you too much more. But it's great because there's a huge magnet in it. And so apparently there are signs if you get too close, it wipes your credit card or something like that. The other cool thing that we're getting is a scanning electron microscope. So we have about 12 to 15 faculty that are interested in using that microscope with their students that will be really, really high resolution. And so we think that will be a game changer. And that won't actually go into this space. That will be on a first floor room in Stillwell that has a lot more stability because you need that stability and kind of quietness in order to get really good high resolution images. So now we are inside the research labs, and you can see how long this lab is. There's about 5 or 6 people working in this. This is the synthesis research lab, so people that make things work here. For example, one of our professors, Chana Da Silva, works on nanoparticles. And so he makes them in these spaces. When we move from the old building, and I was a little surprised, but all the professors agree that we should have these joint research labs because this is really how science works now. There are some other advantages being in kind of a common space. One of those advantages is a safety advantage. So if students are here working in the evenings, there's more likely going to be other people in that space if there's a problem. And you can actually see there's some windows like right there that allows people to see in from the outside. So that also helps with the safety. But the other thing is you know, there are a lot of cost savings and efficiencies by having things because you don't have to necessarily buy as many. People can share kind of within these lab spaces. So we have, I would say, 4 or 5 of these large research labs. And so far, it's been working out really nicely. So this gives you a sense of the types of offices we have. And the one that we're looking at right now is the grad student space. And the idea, they're actually in glass walled areas. And then out in the hall, this is the undergraduate desks that are out in the hall. And across the concrete, so kind of to the other side of the hall, are faculty offices. So you can see those offices as we turn and look through the door. You can see that that's where the faculty are. And so again, the idea is to have people kind of co-located to build that community and build connections because people work in research groups and we want them all to be kind of in close proximity to each other. And so that's kind of what we've designed here in these spaces. So now we're at the kind of the jewel of the building. This is our terrace. And to give you some sense, in a couple weeks, the Board of Governors from the UNC system will be having at least one reception out here. And you obviously get very beautiful views of the mountains in several directions from this area. This has been a great resource, particularly during COVID, because we were able to meet and be out in this space. And it's particularly nice in the fall and the spring before it gets too hot. And it's, you know, really pleasant out here on the in this area. You can see the greenhouse right here that we use for experiments. And then this is the area that's where the natural sciences building used to be. And that's what it looks like right now. It's essentially a mud puddle, particularly today. We had some rain here in Kalawi. But that space is going to be an area that's a garden space. So for those of you who may have visited previously, it used to be the Judicula Garden where we had Cherokee species that were of plants that were important to the Cherokee. That will be coming back along with some additional native plants. So there'll be communities of native plants for classes to look at. Some will have signs, others will be unknown, so the classes can go out there and figure out what they're doing. And we'll also have some boulders out there for the geologists to look at as well. So they'll be able to go down there in that space. The other thing you can see is we're actually going to do some work on those stairs that go up to Hunter Library, so that's going to change quite a bit by the next time that some of you may visit campus. On the terrace, another couple things. One, those blocks that you see, the stones on the pavers, are actually oriented east-west, and that's another thing that's important. The cardinal directions, we were told, are important in Cherokee culture. And so those are all oriented east-west. And then finally, one of the cool things we can do is we actually have our astronomy classes are going to be out on this space as well. We've already had some community events where people have been able to come and use telescopes with one of our faculty members, Enrique Gomez, and it seems like it's going to be a really good spot to look at the stars. So this is also on the fifth floor. And reminds me to talk a little bit. We did have a budget or part of our budget to do art. And we have some things from our collection, like these prints that are from the herbarium. But over time, we'll have an increased collection. This is the herbarium itself. And so this is the facility where we have all these native plant species that are categorized. And they're in these cabinets. And these cabinets actually are compactable shelves. And that allows them to store them all. So if you're doing a project or you want to know what a species was for a research project, you could contact us and we would help you kind of figure that out. Or you could bring your samples here and compare them to ours. One of our faculty members, Kathy Matthews, and several of her colleagues got a National Science Foundation grant really to help develop this. And so it's a really, really cool space that we're happy about. And then this is what the samples actually look like. So these are actually digital prints of the samples in the herbarium. So those are actually pictures, even though they look three-dimensional. So that's the last room that we're going to see. So in the fall, we had the wonderful opportunity to cut the ribbon and open this up with Senator Apodaca and really celebrate his career and his contributions to the university. I was personally privileged to give he and his family a tour of the building, and it was a really enjoyable time. A lot of political folks from Raleigh and his colleagues were here, along with Peter Hans, who's there on in the right image, the left image, excuse me. He's on the right side of the left image, and he, of course, is the president of the UNC system. So we had a really wonderful event, and we're able to open that up and have people see it. So far, so good. We're learning really how to use the spaces, and of course, we've had COVID. And so I think over time, we'll find that even more of the spaces are being filled, but it didn't take long for students to find their individual nooks and really spread out through the building. And again, we think this will really change the way that we do science going forward. So with that, I will stop talking and open it up for questions.
Dave from Phil Landreth, it says, this facility is beautiful. How did you balance the amount of atrium type space versus research type lab space?
Yeah, I think we really wanted to have a little bit of both, and because we needed to have that seating space. And one of the things we used as a model, particularly for the commons, is the HHS building, which also has a really beautiful kind of atrium space where there's a lot of seating. We thought that might be a little bit big for our building, just because it is in the HHS building. If folks have been in there, it's kind of multiple levels, and it kind of takes up a lot of space that you can't use for research and teaching. So we wanted to make sure we had the space, but it was kind of a challenge thinking about getting the right size of things. And so we kind of started with, well, what are the things we need? And then let's be sure that we don't overdo it. And, the professors, of course, love their research spaces. And so you kind of have to hold them back a little bit. But, it really kind of developed. And I can't say enough, this bond is a game changer for us in the sense that we had a good amount of money to invest and have a really nice size building. And so it kind of kept some of the compromises we would have had to make if it was smaller to a minimum. Not that we got everything that people wanted, but there were a lot of things we were able to accommodate in this building.
Thank you. Next question. Do you have staff to reconfigure the classroom furniture for each class?
We do not. That's a little bit of a DIY kind of operation. So practice for this seems to be, and I should mention that we have done this kind of thing for the reconfigurations elsewhere on campus. One of the cool things we've been doing for a few years prior to this building is kind of playing with the furniture design. So we have some groups on campus that have been experimenting. And one of the things that we've determined is it's key to have kind of a default setting. So you have a place that you move things back to. And then hopefully, if you're a teacher who can kind of motivate the students, you get them to move things the way that you would like it to be. And, you know, I think if you set that at the beginning, they'll kind of readily get into space. You know, people are creatures of habit, so students will get in there and arrange it kind of the way that it needs to be arranged. But, yeah, we don't have people to do that right now.
This is from Marie Carter. It says, great building. Like to see the flexible space. Were students involved in the planning aspects, and how were they involved?
Yeah, I believe there was some student there were some student panels. You know, obviously, we have a lot of side students. Probably, I would say 500 or 600 STEM majors, and so obviously we couldn't hear from everybody, but we did consult with some folks. And then, you know, part of it's looking at other buildings. So we went to other places and kind of heard about what they liked and what they didn't like. And then some of it is kind of what do we want to achieve? And we had help from the architects and also kind of a consultant who really specializes in science buildings. And she is does some conferences all over the country and allowed us to kind of get some ideas about what we need to be doing with this space. So that was a really good experience.
Very good. Next question. What size lab or number of bench modules do you assign for your faculty?
Well, we basically we tried to get the spaces and try to get it proportional. And right now it kind of works. So everybody gets probably about one bench module at the moment, and it kind of depends on which lab you're in. One of the hard things is, you know, we initially assign things based on common interests, and of course that the faculty may change, the people's interests may change over time. And so at some point that theme part may not work. We may need to kind of mix groups depending on the spaces, but essentially all of them get probably about one bench and maybe three or four hoods. But also some of it depends. There are a few of our faculty that work with tons of undergraduate students. And so they, you know, they may have kind of carved out some additional space in some of the labs.
Next question. Was there a rationale for the natural light?
Yeah, I think we really wanted to be, to have a lot of light inside. I mean, one of the issues with the other building was it was really dark on the inside. And so we wanted to be as welcoming as possible and take advantage of the natural setting around us. So that was a big motivation. And also, you know, I just think practically by having those windows allows the light in. And so it gets, you know, gets kind of deeper into the building. And so nobody's in a dungeon. There were a lot of dungeon-like spaces in the old natural science building, for those of you who remember. And this kind of keeps that from happening.
Okay, the next question from Pam Hardy, and I believe you did cover this earlier, but she's asking, not sure if I missed it, but what was in the place of this building prior to the building?
Yeah, so a good chunk of it was actually kind of a grassy area. There's a grassy slope that came down from the end of Memorial Drive, and that slope, underneath the slope, was basically where the bleachers were for the old Memorial Stadium. Prior to that, it was was Memorial Stadium. And then prior to that, there actually are pictures of it being a cornfield. And then, of course, now we know that it was probably part of a Cherokee settlement, the Two Sparrows place, when we go even farther back. And so we have great archaeological evidence. And one of the cool things about the building is that we have consultants that did the archaeology, but our faculty and also our students did some work here as part of that effort, which was pretty amazing. It's great when you can use the campus as a laboratory for your students.
Thank you. Next question from Whitney Wilson from the Washington, D.C. area. Do you see this building being a model for other science buildings in North Carolina and the university system? It's really quite stunning and innovative.
Yeah, I think that it is. I'm going to give a presentation in a couple weeks, actually, in a conference in Boston. It's actually, you know, for people that are building science buildings, and certainly we're very proud of the way that it turned out. Thrilled with our architects, LAS from Atlanta, and they were great partners in this. So I think that it is, you know, I think a lot of the things are probably best practices, and you might find some of this kind of in whatever building it is that, you know, would see a new science building. But, you know, we really wanted to reflect kind of what Western is and take advantage of the environment around, as well as the history of the institution. So those are probably things that are pretty unique to us, but there's some elements of the way that we are teaching, I think, that are definitely transferable to other places.
Sure. Thank you. From Marie Carter, are alumni able to do self-guided tours?
Yeah, this building is open all the time. You know, I think we close it on Sunday is the only day that things are locked. And so it's an active building, and people can come in and go hang out on the terrace. If folks want to let me know that you're here, I'd love to visit with you and show you around a little bit if I have time, or we can find somebody else to do that. So, you know, we'd love to be able to welcome you into the building. But yeah, it's open, and we would encourage people to kind of wander around and look at the inside spaces and just kind of take it in, because you know, it's something we're really proud of, and certainly want everybody to be a part of it.
Is there a place we can go online to watch the construction of the building?
Well, most of it is wrapped up at the moment, so I don't think that we still have any sort of feeds online. The parts that we have kind of left to do, there's some kind of random. For a while, I think we had feeds, or at least, you know, pictures of the progress, but I think that's been concluded. At this point, we need to do the garden, and so I'm not sure what the timeline is for that. And then we need to, we have some holes in Stillwell where it used to connect to the old natural sciences building. And so right now, that's what they're working on, is filling those holes and making them windows out into that space. And then, as I mentioned, when we were up on the terrace, we're hoping soon to kind of work on the stairs that come down from the library as well. So there'll be some construction there at some point. But at this point, there's unfortunately no way to kind of look at that. Occasionally we do post pictures on our Instagram feed along with all the other fun stuff that we're doing. So the College of Arts and Science Instagram feed, maybe, or even the university social media, may be a place to go as we're doing fun stuff. We'll try to post pictures of that.
Okay. Next question from Jerry Matheny, longtime supporter from the Atlanta area. What is the bulk of Stillwell now used for?
Well, we actually have, you know, we actually still have quite a bit of space in there that's used for science. So the Department of Geosciences and Natural Resources basically is on the third and fourth floors of the wing that goes out towards Hunter. And then biology is on the second and first floors. They have their anatomy and physiology labs are there. And there's some kind of microbiology on the first floor, along with that's where we're going to put the scanning electron microscope. And then the rest of the building is still very similar to the way it's been in recent years. Basically, we have, you know, political science, philosophy, communications, and math that are on the wing that goes towards the new building. And eventually, we're hoping to have some work done soon that's gotten slowed down a little bit because of the pandemic and some of the difficulty getting work done. But we hope by next fall that we'll have physics labs that are actually in Stillwell, but adjoining the new building on the first floor. And so that will be used now for physics instruction.
Very good. Thank you. Now from Neil Andrews, president of the WCU Alumni Association. His question is, are there specific areas of study or research that this tremendous facility positions Western faculty and students?
Well, I think what it does is it allows us to do research at probably a much bigger level, and we're hoping to also leverage it to bring in more students than we already have. I'm very proud of the fact that I think, you know, at least since I've been here, we've been very oriented towards undergraduate research, and we have two master's programs, one in the sciences, one in biology, and one chemistry. And so they'll be using these spaces. But I think we're hoping that'll allow us to continue to attract really good students, allow us to attract faculty, and also to be able to, you know, bring in grants and leverage the building for those kind of things, that we now have the space. We're not really space limited. And we're also hoping, you know, that that will allow us to make build more successful students. You know, they're in these spaces that are built really for learning science, and that by the time they leave, that they'll benefit by having those spaces, that community, those instrumentation and things that allow them to learn science better. So I think there are a lot of benefits of these spaces, and just want to keep bringing in the students and giving those experiences.
Thank you. Next question from Richard Pegg. It says, there are certainly older buildings on campus than the 1978 science building. Was it simply just worn out?
Well, we had quite a bit of wear on it. And, you know, because science is, you know, requires so much services, for example, the air handling, we had problems with the pipe. There was mold in a lot of the spaces. You know, nothing really worked tremendously well. Plus, we really had no seating. And so it was really time in order to, if we wanted to really continue to do things well, to move into a new building. With that said, we're also looking at, you know, what I guess renovating one of those older spaces, more building, in the next time. We're starting to do planning for that, which we're also very excited about. So certainly just trying to make good spaces for learning on campus. And, you know, I think there's a period of time since I've been here where really the class sizes have grown a little bit, maybe to where we have a lot of classes in the 40s and in the sciences probably in the 60s. And so this also allows us to accommodate some of those particularly intro classes, although our upper level classes are probably still in the 20s and the teens for most of these disciplines. So having those spaces really helps accommodate the new enrollments that we have now at Western.
Another question from Whitney Wilson. Does the building have capability for solar power, or was any consideration given to incorporating solar for this building?
I think what we determined, and this was kind of more on the facilities end, but we do not have solar in terms of this building. I think they looked into that along with some other, you know, certainly some of the energy saving things, and determined that was kind of cost prohibitive. But the amazing thing about, you know, this building, and I was told kind of as we're developing it, you know, just the everything works so much more efficiently, and the control systems are so much better in a building like this that it really allows us to save energy. And so that's kind of one of the nice things about building a new building as opposed to retrofitting something that's older.
Next question. How will faculty staff engage with high school students who have an interest in science to be involved with this new facility?
Well, we really want to reach out to high school students, and I think this allows us to do that. You know, we sponsor an annual science fair here. You know, and one thing we're thinking about is kind of, you know, whether we can move part or some of that into the new building. And certainly for school groups that want to come to campus, we really want them to be aware of the space, because it also helps really start to talk about the important thing, which is the mentoring that students get here at Western, which I would argue is as good as you'll get anywhere in terms of learning science or really any of the disciplines in the college. But we work really closely with students. So we've been reaching out, and certainly have had some school groups kind of come through. And if people are on campus or would like to come to campus, we certainly are open for giving them tours and or having them do, you know, in some cases, students come and do experiences in our labs or other spaces. So we're certainly open to that. And that's really a goal of mine, is to reach out to students and say, hey, if you're a great STEM student, we have a number of awesome programs, and you'll get to do things like undergraduate research here at Western.
Next question. Hello, I find this building quite stunning. Well done for this work. As an associate professor, what was your first impression when you came into this science building? Thank you so much for having us tonight.
Well, you know, we had worked on it, I think it was from maybe 2017 up to this fall. And so there was kind of a sense of relief because we needed to really use the space in the fall. So once I got through that, You know, I just think it's a really stunning space. It's really welcoming and warm inside. As students started to go in, there's a real sense of pride that they're using the spaces kind of how you would envision them using it. They always find ways to use it ways that you maybe didn't think of, but that's awesome too. And so, you know, really a sense of pride and a little bit of kind of amazement that we have this facility here and we can use it. When I started teaching in the fall, it was just like, wow, this is awesome to have this space. It also was a lot of work just to kind of move everything and get it unpacked, particularly for the fall. And so there was a pretty big sense of relief when we're finally ready to go with it. So I look forward to having, you know, more time to kind of grow into the space as we go on in subsequent years.
Well, Dean Kenner, thank you so much for being part of this evening's special program and providing a personal tour of this incredible Apodaca Science Building. Thanks for listening to this month's Western Wednesday. For additional content, visit go.wcu.edu/podcast. And as always, go Cats!